Okay, let's say amen for our Facebook audience that's coming on.
Amen.
Amen. And so we want you all to get your Bibles out as well. And I want you to understand some things about the kingdom of God. We was talking about shifting it into high gear, right? We've been, for a month ago, January, we was talking about shifting into high gear. And one thing that God was saying to me is that it's imperative that we as Christians discover our position in the kingdom. And I think that's what we've been missing. And I really did not know about the kingdom. All I knew about was church. So therefore, all of my association with God had to do with church and not the kingdom. So I really did not walk in the benefits of God that I could have, because I didn't know they existed.
Right.
I didn't know that. I thought the kingdom of heaven was when we go to heaven. So I thought that we were doing, I thought that we were doing all this work and working out our soul salvation for the sole purpose of getting to heaven. And so all I was taught all my life is that, you know, you're going to get your rewards, you're going to get your shoes, your golden slippers when you get to heaven. And you was going to get a long white robe and you're going to get a crown when you get to heaven. And so my thing is, for me, I ain't ready to go. I'm going, but I don't want to go today. Ain't no shoes for me here. Now, y'all don't ask questions like that. I ask silly questions. That was one of them. Because I did not understand why everything had to be given to me in heaven, but I'm living here. Okay? So what I learned is in Genesis, when it came to the kingdom, we lost our place. When Adam sinned, we lost our place in the kingdom. We lost our citizenship. We lost our property. We lost our territory. Right? Which means the kingdom did not exist to us. Because you cannot have a kingdom without territory. And you cannot have a kingdom without citizens.
Right.
And remember, if for example, we use the Garden of Eden as the modern day earthly kingdom that God set up here on earth, and we use that, the Garden of Eden, as our guideline for the kingdom, remember, after he said, after God clothed them, he kicked them out. And he put an angel at the edge of the gate so they could not return. So it was a symbol of how we lost our place and we got kicked out of the kingdom that God had for us. And so we had to understand that it took all that time for God to reestablish. Because think about this. That's when Jesus then came and reestablished the kingdom. So we lost the kingdom with Adam, but we gained the kingdom when Jesus was crucified, death, burial, resurrection.
Yes.
Are y'all following me?
Yes.
Okay. So what I really start realizing is he kept saying things like the kingdom of God is at hand.
Right.
Is at hand means the kingdom of God is right now. So I kept wondering, Lord, why is it that we're teaching people that the kingdom of heaven is in heaven when he's saying the kingdom of God is at hand and he's here? So it started making me think and start going into what is this kingdom business and what does that have to do with me? Anybody want to know? I think you should know. I think it's important enough and you should know where you stand in the kingdom. So listen, I want y'all to type on the screen and write this down. There are two kingdoms. I think I touched bases with it last week, but we're going to touch bases and then we're going to move into it this week. The first kingdom is the earthly kingdom. Okay? Somebody say the earthly kingdom.
The earthly kingdom.
Y'all type that on the screen. The earthly kingdom. I want you to understand there are two kingdoms. The first kingdom is the earthly kingdom. Okay? This world refers to the earth and those who inhabit the earth. We you're technically in the earthly kingdom, whose function is day-to-day is to be apart from God. The world, they're functioning, they function, and their function is apart from God. It is a system that has been established and ruled by Satan. So this worldly kingdom is ruled by Satan. I know that I messed with some of y'all religion. God knew everything. No, he kicked Satan out of heaven. He kicked him to earth and gave him rulership on earth. Prove it, huh? Prove it? Let's prove it. Let's go. Somebody go to John 12, verse 31. Somebody go to John 12, verse 31. Praise the Lord. Go to John 12, verse 31. Somebody else go to John 16, 7 through 11. Somebody's in John 12, 31. Somebody else is in John 16, 7 through 11. And then somebody else, I need you to go to 1 John 5, 19. Okay? So in three scriptures, write that. Somebody put that on the screen. John 12, 31. The second is John 16, 7 through 11. 1 John 5, verse 19. We're establishing that the ruler of this earth world is Satan. Okay? Of the earthly kingdom. Okay? Somebody read John 12, verse 31. Go.
The time of judgment for the world has come, and the time when Satan, the prince of this world, shall be cast out.
They called him the prince of what?
This world.
The prince of what?
This world.
The prince of what?
This world.
So he's the prince of this world, okay? Somebody go to John 16, 7 verses 11, 7 through 11.
But I tell you the truth. It's better for you that I go away. When I go away, I will send the helper to you. If I do not go away, then the helper will not come. When the helper comes, he will prove to the people of the world the truth about sin, about being right with God, and about judgment. He will prove to them about sin, because they don't believe in me. He will prove to them that I am right with God, because I am going to the Father. You will not see me anymore. And the helper will prove to them the truth about judgment, because the ruler of this world is already judged.
Read verse 11 again.
Okay. Verse 11 again. And the helper will prove to them the truth about judgment, because the ruler of this world is already judged.
There's a ruler of this world. Okay? We already know that he's the prince of this world, right? He's also the ruler of this world. Somebody go to 1 John 5, verse 19. 1 John 5, 19.
We know that we are of God, and the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one.
Of who?
The wicked one.
Okay, you got a different version? Go ahead.
We know that we are of God, and that the whole world lies in the power of the evil one.
The evil one, the wicked one. Who is that?
Satan.
So, the Bible is establishing that the whole world lies under the power of the evil one, of Satan. Of the evil one. So the evil one is the ruler, the prince of this world. Y'all got that?
Uh-huh.
So we understand that in the first kingdom is ruled, listen, by Satan. Okay? And what I want you to understand is that the system is already in place. The system, his kingdom is already established. Can I say something to you? And I think this is where it's going to really get interesting. Satan's kingdoms are really ruled by self, greed, pride, and lust.
Yes.
Usually, when somebody, and what we've deduced it to, and I think I told you last week, When it comes to Satan, he always tackles your emotions, your feelings, and your desires. Everything has to do with what you feel like. Or you talk about self, what benefits you. Remember, we started talking about your call. Your call is not for you. Your call is for somebody else. But guess what? Your call can be tainted when it's about you.
Yes.
But many think about this. Even when we talk about greed and things of that nature, it's self.
Yeah.
When we talk about lust, it's about our feelings and our emotions. When you get in a bad relationship, it's something got to do with your feelings. When you make bad decisions, it's usually got something to do with your feelings. Oh, y'all ain't listening.
Yeah.
But people that kill have to do something with their feelings. People that become enraged, wrath, feelings, emotions, or desires. You wind up being with the wrong one. You lay down with the wrong one. It usually has to do with your desire. You were lonely and you desired some company. Come on.
Yeah.
So everything what the enemy does is the enemy has assigned himself to make sure that we're always either in our feelings, our emotions, or our desires. You always mad. Okay, so guess what? The joy of the Lord is not your strength because the enemy has attacked your feelings. So therefore, all I got to do is put this on you today. Okay, y'all.
Yeah.
So all I got to do, and it's easy. The trick is easy. All I got to do is do something to make you mad, and now your whole day is ruined because you're in your feelings, your emotions, and your desires. So now you no longer believe God. You just heard the word yesterday. Oh, can I give you an example? I was Saturday, Sunday, the word came that the Lord is going to grow us despite of the interference. There's going to be interference. Guess what happened on Monday? There was interference. Something came and wanted me, listen, I wanted to go off. But the Lord reminded me, it's interference. Shut your mouth. So guess what I did? I shut my mouth. See what I mean? Because what he wanted me to do is tackle my emotions. So now, I'm not acting in the spirit. Now I'm acting in Bo. Because Bo needs to respond to you. Because your text message wasn't cool. So let me respond to you how Bo will respond. Y'all don't ready. Y'all ain't ready. But guess what God did? God said, shut up and sit yourself down somewhere and let me rise up in you.
Yeah.
I started saying stuff. I started typing stuff. I was like, I know I ain't saying that. I ain't know I ain't being nice. But guess what? I wind up, and guess what? Didn't feel nothing about it because I realized, I'm beginning to start realizing that the kingdom is trying to get me to make sure that I stay conformed to this world. So as long as I keep my mind in this world, I can never grab what he has for me in that. Okay, y'all got that. I don't feel as sick today. I feel all right. Listen, can I tell you this? And this is gonna hurt your feelings. I'm gonna hurt your feelings, and I'm gonna bandage you back up. But I'm gonna hurt your feelings first. What I want you to understand about the kingdom of this earth is that demons. Satan and demons are organized.
Yeah.
Okay, y'all, okay. We about to let's get them a chair, please. Let's make sure they got this open. Then you know they got to sit by each other. So let me put this chair. But listen. They are organized. Can I tell you this? The Satan is organized. You've never seen in the Bible a demon fight another demon.
Right.
Or a devil fight another devil. You ain't never seen, they have a chain of command. Oh, y'all know, y'all okay. They have a chain of command. Their organism, they have order. The kingdom of Satan. He said, what is your name? He said, we are legion. They talked as one. There were 6,000 of them that talked as one. There may have been confusion and all of this stuff, perversion, all this, but when they talk as one leader.
Right.
See, and what you don't understand, think about this. What you're not understanding, and what I love about God, what we need to enlighten ourselves, when your attack comes, it's organized.
Yeah.
It's not a happenstance that he attacked your emotions today to make you upset. It was organized. You ain't organized.
Right.
Now let me tell you how. Can I tell you why? Can I give you a reason why? Because before they were demons, they were angels.
Right.
And they were in heaven, and your God is a God of order.
Right.
Think about this. When he stepped out into nothing, he said, let there be. It was chaos. And he set things in order first. Because he couldn't deal in chaos. So what he did, he said, a house divided against itself cannot stand. The only house, listen, the only house to have the division is church folk. Okay, y'all. Okay. You can't listen. Is this church versus that church?
Right.
My church is bigger and better than your church. It's singer versus singer. Mm-hmm. I ain't never seen no demon sit up there and talk about another demon singing. But somebody sitting in church will talk about yours.
Yeah.
We are the most unorganized, uninformed, unequipped people. And I don't understand. It's a trick of the enemy because guess what? He's coming for your emotions every single day.
Yeah.
Wow.
He's coming for your emotions, your desires, and your feelings. Yeah. Think about it. Every morning, you don't feel like giving God glory.
Yeah.
Why? Nothing happened. You just woke up, and now you don't feel like it. They call it on the road. You got an attitude that you just got here.
Yeah.
It's always too cold. It's always too hot. It's always too something. You never have enough money. Listen, boo, you ain't never going to have enough money.
Right.
If you're a visionary and you got vision, you will never have enough money. But you're frustrated because you ain't got money to go buy you this and buy you that. So guess what? The trick of the enemy is to get you to curse God and die.
Yeah, that's right.
So let me organize against Ty today, because I know she don't like that co-worker.
Well.
So let me organize and get her to mess with her today, to throw off her whole day. So now you ain't did nothing. You ain't even thought about the kingdom. All you did is think about the co-worker. See, we thinking the devil do big things to us. But he messes with your day in subtleties.
Yes.
It's subtle. And if you, because most of us are ignorant to his kingdom and his work, we allow it to happen.
Right.
Speak life.
That's right.
Speak life, but you wake up speaking death. Because what you feel.
Right.
How you doing? Oh. How many times have we asked you how you feel and you tell us your problems first?
Yeah.
How you doing? Oh, this is a rough day. Because you called it and you allowed the enemy whose job is to throw you off.
Yeah.
Throw you off. I hurt you, didn't it? I know it hurt you because it hurt me when I read it. But he's organized. We're not organized. He plans things. You don't plan to read the Bible.
Uh-huh.
You don't plan to pray. It just happens. That's how you forget. Because it's not meaningful enough to you, or you ain't recognized it yet to realize I'm getting beat up. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's true.
Okay. So we're getting beat up by the earthly kingdom because we're in it, and guess what? We're taking it because we're calling it life, and we're calling it like that's how life is supposed to be. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Or how about this? Why is this happening to me? Or why is God allowing this to happen to me? And then you list all of your good qualities. I go to church. I go to Bible study. And don't we do it?
Oh, yeah.
And guess what? The trick. We done lost. We done lost to the trick. Because the trick was to get you to say it in the first place. The trick was to get you to doubt him in the first place. So when we talk about the kingdom, we have to understand that the kingdom of earth is established here already. And the ruler of darkness, listen, the ruler, the evil one, the wicked one, the prince of the air, that's who rules this kingdom. Go to Galatians, because I think y'all quiet, like I'm still lying. Y'all think I'm lying?
We're just listening.
Galatians 1 and 4. Go to Galatians 1 and 4. Somebody else go to James 4 and 4. Galatians 1 and 4. Somebody else go to James 4 and 4.
Who gave himself for our sins so that he might rescue us from this present evil age according to the will of our God and Father.
Okay. Somebody else? And James 4 and 4.
So you people are not loyal to God. You should know that loving the world is the same as hating God. Yeah. So if a person wants to be a friend of the world, he makes himself God's enemy. Ooh. Ooh.
Okay. So he's saying that because you understand, now that you come into the knowledge, now that you've come into the knowledge of who is the ruler of this world, when you compromise and you love it to where you forsake him for it, when you forsake him for it, when you forsake his laws for its laws, when you forsake his ways for its ways, he was like, you become lovers of the world, not me.
Yeah.
Now, it's so funny. Can I say this? It's funny. We'll sit up and ask a whole bunch of Christians, how many of you love God? Mm-hmm. Because it's the right answer, we all raise our hand. It's sacrilegious. There's no way I can say, how many of you love Jesus? I get the voice too. How many of you love Jesus? Everybody would be like, I love it. But you won't follow his commandment. You won't forgive. Uh-oh. Because you like holding the grudge. Because it's a part of your feelings, your emotions, and your desires. So it's a trick of the enemy, an organized trick of the enemy to get you not to forgive. But you love it. Okay. You the one starting the division amongst the saints. You took what Sister Rachel told you and told Sister Denise. She told you. But now you done caused division.
Yep. Oh yeah.
You guys heard about
it? Is everything over there in that corner? So he said, if you love the world, you hate me. Mm-hmm. Because guess what? When you love the world and the things of it, and I'm explaining that a little bit deeper, because you're already in it, so how do you deal with the world if you're already in it? If you're living here, I got to love something. I got to deal with it, right?
Right.
So what does he mean by loving the world? What do you think? Come on. Loving the world. What y'all think? What do you mean? What do you think about loving the world? Anybody?
Be comfortable in your sin.
Be comfortable in your sin. Anybody else?
Status quo.
Status quo, okay.
Not standing. Not taking a stand. Not trusting.
Not standing, not trusting. Anybody else?
Putting everything before God.
Putting everything before God. How many of us did that before? Anybody else? You said what?
Everything cool.
Everything is cool. Everything is a go. Okay, well let's discuss it. Let's go to Romans 12. Romans 12, verse 2.
Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Yeah.
And then you will be able to rest, to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will.
He said, be not, don't conform to what's happening here.
Uh-huh.
Don't, you got what?
Uh-huh.
Go ahead.
Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world,
uh-huh.
But be a new and different person with a fresh newness in uh-huh. all you do and think.
Uh-huh.
Then you will learn from your own experience how his ways will really satisfy you.
Okay, so he says, do not spend your time conforming to the patterns that you see other folk do.
Yeah.
That's a part of that, that have no knowledge of Jesus Christ.
Right.
Who are you following? Who are you listening to? Who's shaping your household?
Mm.
Who's shaping your culture?
Okay.
I get you. I'm here with you. I'm here for it. It says you got to renew your mind. Let me tell you why. Because if there's a kingdom, that means there's a king.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. For there to be a kingdom, there has to be a king. Now, what does the king do? The king establishes laws,
uh-huh.
decrees,
uh-huh.
and everything in the kingdom, the armies included, follows the decrees and the law of the king.
Yeah.
That's what makes you part of the kingdom, or then you are in rebellion.
Mm.
And that's called treason. You can die for treason. Right? And again, like I told you last week, many of us don't understand kingdom because we're used to democracy.
Right.
You have a voice.
Uh-huh.
You get to say who the president is. In a kingdom, you don't get a say.
Right.
Okay.
All right.
You're either born into it or you inherit the kingdom. You don't get a say. The majority don't get to vote who's the king.
Right.
They just have to hope that it's the right king.
Right. Yeah.
So if there's an earthly kingdom, that means there's a king.
Right.
That has established the laws and decrees on how the world should act.
Mm-hmm.
He said, who are you following?
Right.
Who you with?
Are you following the king of the world,
mm-hmm.
or have you then acknowledged the fact that I extended you grace when you were a sinner?
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord.
And now I'm your king.
Thank you, Lord.
Because I got a different set of rules for you.
Yeah.
Okay. So for me to establish that he has a set of rules, that also is a set of benefits attached to the rules.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because can I say this? Am I going too deep? Because I was hoping I didn't go too deep today. But think about this. Satan will make you think that he got what God got.
Right.
Right.
Have you ever saw Have you ever been around people who they leave the church or they leave God and it seems like they do it fine?
Right. Yeah, right.
And they attested to the fact that I ain't connected to the church no more. So it looks like I'm being blessed. Because think about it, Satan is a deceiver.
That's right.
Yeah.
Just like God knows your heart, Satan knows what you like too.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
So he'll offer you what you like.
Yeah. Right.
He'll your feelings, your emotions, and your desire. He gonna offer you some chocolate. Some chocolate ice cream. With some cookies and cream. With fudge on top. And some Oreo sprinkles. When you're on a diet. That's what he's gonna do for me.
Ouch.
What he ain't gonna do is offer me butter pecan. Because I like it.
He'll offer me that.
He'll offer you that. Guess what? Guess what? Your butter pecan would not move me. I could be on a diet and your butter pecan will sit right there. And I would not care. And I will walk this diet all the way through. But guess what? Give me my chocolate. Listen. And guess what? As soon as you start walking in the kingdom, he gonna present you with what you like.
Right.
You ain't had no date.
Right.
As soon as you start, soon as.
Right.
You start walking in ministry and really loving God, you gonna get text.
Oh,
it ain't going to be nobody new. It's going to be the old one that you used to like. That you was hoping a long time ago that they like you. All of a sudden, they don't see the light. Have you ever thought, why do you still fall for the same type?
Uh-huh.
Different person, same type. Different person, same type. It's because we know in this kingdom what you like. Okay. We know what's going to trip you up.
Yeah.
We know who going to make you mad today.
Yeah.
We know what situation going to make you not believe God today. We know what's going to make you cuss that person out.
Sorry.
We know what's going to make you, and we're going to put, guess what? We're going to put it right in front of you. Because the more you fall.
Yeah.
Can I say this? It works on your own psyche. You start thinking of yourself as less than who you are the more you fall. So I put you in a position to keep on cussing her out. Because every time you cuss out, I remind you that you ain't a Christian for real.
Right.
Yeah.
And that you ain't called to do that.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
So that I'm trying to give you instances of how the enemy works in your life. So he's going to present all the stuff that works on you to get you to be a puppet for him today.
Mm-hmm.
And in 2017, we were puppets. Mm-hmm. We failed for okie doke stuff. Mm-hmm. Not this year. Not this year. Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to read the Amplified of Galatians 1:4 and 12:2. So 1:4 says, "Who gave, yielded himself up to atone for our sins and to save and sanctify us in order to rescue and deliver us from the present wicked age and world order, in accordance with the will and purpose and plan of our God and Father." Mm-hmm. And so we were talking about that Satan has an order, that they have an order that they do things. Uh-huh. And like it's very interesting that like it's order that causes us chaos.
Uh-huh.
And just like makes everything chaotic.
Uh-huh.
So and then
because we allow it, because we don't recognize it. We don't recognize a thing as, oh, this is an assignment, and those who are assigned to me are in order.
Mm.
And they're assigned to get my emotions today.
Yeah.
When you recognize it, listen, now you're able to shed light on it. Mm-hmm. When you shed light on it, listen, nothing, most of our fears are from the dark. Because there's no light on it. Yeah. I can see you with some light. Many of us, the reason why we act on our feelings, our emotions, and our desires is because we didn't shed no light on it. So we allow the organization and the order to come against us, and we lose. And guess what? We either blame ourselves or we blame God. Next one.
Do not be conformed to this world, this age. Fashioned after and adapted to its external superficial customs, but be transformed, changed by the entire renewal of your mind, by its new ideals and its new attitude, so that you may prove for yourselves what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God, even the thing which is good and acceptable and perfect in His sight for you.
There are three things you need to do when it comes to renewal. The first thing you got to do is continuously rehearse. You need to continuously rehearse. Renew your mind says, I need to continuously rehearse. Every day you need to continuously rehearse who you are. The second thing you got to do is resubscribe. You need to resubscribe to the notion that your works is not going to get you to heaven. That should free somebody. I wish somebody would think about their own life and realize it ain't your good works that's going to get you in. Because guess what? Church has made me feel that if I ain't good enough, if I ain't changed this, that I'm not God. Or that I'm not, be ye holy, for I am holy. I can't be. So guess what? Every time I fall, I remind myself that I'm not holy. But He called me. He called me different. He said, I'm justified. So who's important you gonna believe? Hers or you believe yours? Or you believe His? Are you going to believe what this world calls you or what He calls you? I see I'm going to have to work this. I see I'm going to have to work on this. This is going to be real good. By the end of it, you're going to get it. Right now, you feel beat up. But don't feel beat up because we all been there.
Oh, yeah.
Well, we allow the organization and the order of this world to then rule how we and dictate how we operate.
Yeah.
So guess what? Our religion then is stale. Our religion, our connection to God now, we've been walking with God with no benefit all this time because we've subscribed to the notion that we got to do it ourselves.
We got to
subscribe to the notion that we got to fix our own situation. We subscribe to the notion that if we sin, we done messed up and we're not worthy of the call.
Yeah.
Because you should be able to come out of it. Oh yeah. You should be able to change yourself. You should stop cussing. If you love God, why are you cussing? You ain't supposed to cuss if you love God for real. Guess what? It's going to be somebody tomorrow that's going to make me want to cuss them. Boy, y'all don't want to be real today. Y'all trying to act like the holy. Sorry. But guess what? Guess what? It's not my responsibility to stop cussing. It's my responsibility to then continue to hear, so I continue to grow, so I can continue to resubscribe what He called me. Amen. Because what he calls me outweighs who I am.
Right.
Yes.
Let me change that. What he calls me outweighs what I do.
Okay, yeah.
Uh-huh. What I did is what I did. But that's not who I am.
Right.
I am who he calls me to be. So I gotta renew my mind. I gotta resubscribe to who I am. And then I gotta remind myself. I gotta rehearse, do it over again. Resubscribe. That means sometimes you gotta go back and say, God, what do you think about me? Y'all in a relationship. And let me use a case. I mean, don't be vexed. They're in a relationship, right? But every now and then, even though she knows Triple loves her, sometimes there needs to be a reminder.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
There better be. There needs to be a reminder. Yeah. There needs to be some resubscription of why we even got together in the first place.
Right.
What did you like about me in the beginning?
Yeah.
Other words, why are you here? Yeah. See, many of us, we don't resubscribe. We don't never go back to see. He said, you need to go back to your first love. You need to fall in love with me over again.
Yes.
and then you got to remind yourself of who I am to you. That's what relationships do. Through communication and listening.
Mm-hmm.
I listen to find out who you are.
Yeah.
Then I watch your actions. I see you make a way for me over and over again.
Thank you, Lord.
You tell me to give me, bring all my problems to you, and you rub my head. Mm-hmm. Tell me it's going to be okay.
Yeah.
And I can make it another day. Guess what? Now, are you going to subscribe to that? Are you going to subscribe to the one who says you ain't going to make it? Because that's who you got whispering in your ear.
Yeah.
Or at least that's who you had. I changed that word verbiage. That's who you had whispering in your ear in 2017. The one who kept telling you what you're not. So then when you decide to resubscribe and remind yourself and rehearse what the kingdom says about you, you start seeing some changes in your benefits. Because guess what? He said, I'm about to go. Oh, I'm going to get y'all to listen. Oh, this is good. Go to Ephesians 2. Oh, this is good. Oh, y'all gonna love me. Y'all gonna love me when you read this. But you could have read it yourself. Go to Ephesians 2, 1 through 7. Ephesians 2, 1 through 7, and read it slow.
Once you were under God's curse, doomed forever for your sins.
Uh-huh.
You went along with the crowd and were just like all the others.
Uh-huh.
Full of sin, obeying Satan, the mighty prince of the power of the air, who is at work right now in the hearts of those who are against the Lord.
Right now, go ahead.
All of us used to be just as they are.
All of us in the room.
Our lives expressing the evil within us, doing every wicked thing that our passions or our evil thoughts might lead us into. We started out bad, being born with evil natures, and were under God's anger just like everyone else.
But God is
so rich in mercy.
Thank you, Lord.
He loved us so much that even though we were spiritually dead and doomed by our sins, he gave us back our lives again when he raised Christ from the dead. Only by his undeserved favor have we ever been saved and lifted us up from the grave into glory along with Christ, where we sit with him in the heavenly realms. All because of what Christ Jesus did.
Okay. Y'all didn't get happy because y'all don't even know what that means. But what he said was, he said, all of us in the room, all of us was following Satan.
Right?
All of us, that's what we did. That was natural to us because Satan is the ruler of this world. We got that? Uh-huh. Satan is the ruler of the world. He's the ruler of this earthly kingdom. He said, but God. Somebody say, but God.
But God.
But God extended three things to you as a benefit of the kingdom. This is before you get the benefits. This ain't got to do with provision. This ain't got nothing to do with seeking first the kingdom. It ain't got to do with that yet. Because we're going to start that next week. We're going to show you what the benefits are. But you got to start with this. The first thing he did is he provided mercy. Mercy. Okay. Because for those of us who are slow, who don't know what mercy is. Mercy is that I'm not going to get the punishment that I deserve. Because he kind, he tenderhearted, and he loved me. Okay. Now he may not love y'all, but I know he provides me mercy so that when I was loving what I was doing, he says that while you were yet sinners, Christ died for you. When you was his enemy, he loved you enough to call you out of that and say, you're mine. And so I'm going to give you mercy because you should have died. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to send somebody in your place. Listen, I like you. I love you. But I'm not sending my daughter to die for you.
Thank you, Lord.
And I sure ain't doing it. So if you ain't got nothing to thank God for, you better thank God that I ain't God.
Right.
Cause y'all would have been messed up.
Oh my God.
Cause think about this. How is it that he'll send his son to die for you and you still sin? On purpose. But guess what? He loves you so much that he looked beyond that.
Thank you, God.
And he don't see what you're doing. He only sees who you are. That's a good benefit of the kingdom. That's a good benefit of the kingdom. That what I do is not who I am. Because he called me a royal priesthood. A chosen generation. So how can he choose me and call me a chosen generation when I still cuss you out? When I still don't want to forgive.
Mercy. Thank you, Yahweh.
It's because one of the benefits of the kingdom is mercy.
Thank you, Yahweh.
What church wants you to feel is judgment.
Yes.
Yeah.
But he said, I need you to elevate your mind. And stop condemning yourself. And stop allowing other folk to condemn you. Because if you in me, I'm sending mercy.
Thank you.
And guess what? It's brand new.
Right.
Every single one. So you can use all of your mercy today. And you still got more tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thank you, Yahweh.
Lord.
Yeah.
He said the wages of sin is death. But my gift of mercy is you get eternal life. He said the payment has already been paid. So you don't even have to trip on. Listen, because you have received me, you only have to trip on the payment.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
The Bible says Zechariah, there was Joshua standing in front of the high priest. And the Bible said Satan was standing there to accuse him. Yes, Joshua did it. Yes, Stephanie did it. Yes, Denise did it. Darnell did it. He did all of it. But guess what? The Bible says that the devil, the Lord said, Satan, the Lord rebuked you. He said, Satan, I rebuke you. Oh, y'all didn't hear me. He said, Satan, the Lord rebuked you. He said, this is the one that I snatched out the fire. And he said, put him on a new turban. And put him on some new clothes. Take the dirty off of him and put something new on him. Because it's not what you call him, it's what I call him. Okay. So when he gave you brand new mercy, that was a benefit of the kingdom. Because what he wanted to do is make sure that you didn't die. So you were already dead. But let me tell you what happened. The second benefit of the kingdom is that you were resurrected. Okay, y'all.
Thank you.
You got up. Okay, let's say that again. Resurrection means you were dead. And he called you like he come out of it.
Yeah.
A benefit of the kingdom is that no matter how dead it is, he can call it back to life. Yeah. And that means I can.
Yes.
Okay. My dead finances, I can call the things back to life. My dead relationship, I can call it back to life. Because guess what? When he got up, guess who got up?
You did. You did.
I guess we don't understand what resurrection power is. Resurrection means you were dead. You were walking around here living, but dead. You were walking around here, but because you were attached and you were giving your loyalty and giving your love and giving to your attention to the kingdom, the earthly kingdom, you were dead.
Yeah.
Which means you were just, your days were just numbered. He said the devil comes, the Satan comes, or the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But when you send me, I come to give you life. So he said, so I thought that life was only in heaven. Life is here. He said, the day you accepted me, you started living here. Well, y'all didn't want to hear me. You don't have to wait to get there to start living like you up there. Okay, y'all. You were dead because you were dead because you didn't really get the benefits. You got a counterfeit benefit. Because we think about this, you got a counterfeit blessing because it came from the deceiver. But guess what? When you got with me, he said the blessing of the Lord make it rich and added no sorrow to it. So when I bless you, there's nobody that can unbless you.
Come on now.
So the benefit is that I called you out of that dead situation so you can walk up here with me on earth. But then the third thing, and I'm done, I gotta close this thing out. I'm going somewhere. I'm gonna eat this, I'm eating, I'm going to bed. But let me tell you what the third one is.
Okay.
The third one is, he called you, and not only did he give you mercy, not only did he give you the ability to be resurrected, the third thing is where he put you. He took you, and he didn't resurrect you for you to just walk. Bible says, I wish y'all look at your Bible. He said, you are now seated. You are now seated with him.
In the heavenly
realms. Okay, I know y'all don't think so because y'all seated in here with me. I know you don't see it. But what he's saying is that what you are where you are right now is when you receive me as your Savior, you're now seated in a different position. And the reason why the enemy is attacking you so is because when you're seated in a different position, you have a different perspective.
Right.
I'm not looking at the situation head on. I'm looking from above. And guess what? That brings a whole new meaning of seek ye first the kingdom. Because I'm already sitting in it. He said, you sit next to the Father. So that means when you get up to walk around, that's why he said you can come back boldly to the throne of grace. Because you're already seated up there. There's a seat. I know we thought that the seat was when you get to heaven and you die. But he said you are now seated. Okay, y'all. In the spirit, you are now seated.
Yeah.
I'm going to say that again. In the spirit, you are now seated. So that means when he called you royal priesthood, it's because your spirit, because you are already there. He calls you a royal priesthood because royalty is associated with kingdom.
Right.
So you're living here on earth, but you're already in kingdom. So therefore, he calling you from your position. Your position is already in kingdom. You just now, it's up to you to bring kingdom here. That's why he said, on earth as it is in heaven. Whatever is happening in heaven supposed to be happening in here. Okay. So if you're not defeated in heaven,
And you're not never defeated in heaven.
I think you got it. So if it's not happening in heaven, why is it happening here?
Right.
If you're not defeated in heaven, why are you letting the devil beat you up here and calling it life? Yeah, you're going to suffer. Yeah, you're going to go through some things. But guess what? He said, guess what? Thank you, Lord. He said, Satan, where's you going?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That means Satan came up to where he was.
Yeah.
He didn't go to where Satan was. Satan still has access to where he is. So he sees you.
Right.
In your heavenly seat.
Right.
And say, I can't touch Maisha because she's sitting next to you.
Yeah.
Okay, y'all didn't catch me.
Yeah.
I can't touch Joe because you got a hedge over. Joe didn't see the hedge.
That's right.
Joe was just living. Joe didn't see the hedge. But the hedge was around him because the enemy saw it all the way in heaven. There's a hedge. I can't touch Tiana because you got a protection around her.
Right.
She's sitting next to you. I can't get to her because of you. I want to, but I can't. I want Junior. I want him so bad. But he's next to you.
Yeah.
And guess what? We are the ones who relinquish our position. So therefore, that's why the enemy gets to touch us. Because we don't know where we see it. So that's why it says, think about this. That's why the Lord can say, the word can say, no weapon formed against you shall be able to prosper. Because the word or the weapon got to go through him first. When you see it, where you supposed to be. But when you decide to conform and let this king operate in your life, you get what you get.
Right. Yeah.
Because guess what? Sister Rachel, can I say this? It's your choice.
He
said, I put the choice in your mouth.
That's right.
Wow.
You get to choose.
Yeah.
Listen, he said, this is how much power you got. Can I tell you how much power you got? He said, this day, this could be tomorrow, could be the next day. This day, you choose life or death.
Yes.
Which means you choose where you're seated.
Right.
Because you have dual citizenship.
Right.
You're here on earth, but you in the kingdom. You choose where you're gonna operate today. He said you choose life or death. You get to choose blessing or cursing. You get to choose whether you're gonna have life today. Because it said this day.
This day. Yeah.
Or how much y'all get this? This will change your life if you get it. He said, you get to choose whether you're gonna be blessed today or cursed today. Think about your life. Where you are right now, you chose it.
Right,
yeah.
You called it. You broke because you called it. You said, I'm sick. Yeah, you were presented with the symptoms, but you didn't have to take it.
Yeah.
Because I can choose life today. I got cancer, but I choose life.
Yeah.
I got HIV, but I choose life. Because no disease can live in my body if he's in it. Now, let me take my communion.
Hello.
I get to choose whether I'm going to be happy today.
Yeah.
I can choose not to be depressed. I can choose my relationships.
Yeah.
He said, you get the choice. You get the choice
Because you're supposed to be choosing from a different seat.
If you were in the heavenly places, if you're in the heavenly place, that means you got a different perspective. You got a different view. I'm looking down on it. So I can make a decision. Hey, God, what you think? What you think about this?
Right. All right.
Because I'm seated with him.
Right. Right.
I know y'all thought seated in heavenly places thought when we get to heaven, we gon'. I'm not going. What I gotta wait for that for? And that's been the problem. We've been getting beat up by the enemy who is organized. And what his job is to make sure you don't know where you are. And you make sure you don't know what your position is.
Yeah.
My position is in him. Mm-hmm. And if I'm in him, I'm where he is. If any man, think about this, be in Christ,
yes,
he is a new creature.
Yes.
I still do old stuff, but I'm a new creature because I'm in a different space.
Right.
So when he sees me, he won't even see. He sees Jesus. Because between me and God is another seat.
Right.
Oh, y'all didn't catch that.
Yeah.
God here. Jesus here. Me here, and the Spirit of God is in me. Can I suggest something to you? And I don't know. No, I ain't gonna say that. I gotta study that. Could that possibly be part of the triune? Here it is. He said, "You seated next to Jesus, who's sitting next to God, and the Holy Spirit is in you." Okay, I'm saying it again. God is seated here. Jesus is on his right hand.
Right.
And he said, "My seat is next to Jesus, but the Holy Spirit is within me."
Yeah.
Think about this in Genesis. The whole process was, let's make man in
our image
and in our likeness.
Right.
So when could it be when Jesus died, he sent a part of him to be with you, so that you can be with him right now. So when you get called home, you're just going home.
Right.
Yeah.
I promise you, if we get our spirit to open up to this, our whole lives gonna change. Because you're gonna walk in a whole different, you're gonna start calling things out that's that be not as though they were. You're gonna start calling businesses out. You're going to establish things on earth that's already in heaven, and you're gonna start seeing the manifest. Because when you think about it, if it's God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit is inside of you, that means when you talk, he talk.
Yes. All right.
And when God said, "Let there be," there was no choice. I gotta go. There was no choice for the firmaments of the heaven. There was no choice for the birds. They had to come. He created it.
Yeah.
He created it and then gave the dominion to you.
Yep.
He said, "Be fruitful, multiply, replenish, subdue. And have dominion."
Yeah.
He gave all of the stuff to you.
Mm-hmm.
Adam said, took it back. Say, "Darnell, get out of here." Jesus died, he gave it back.
Yeah.
But we still act like we
don't have it.
Don't have it.
Yeah.
So we take it else.
Wow.
I know that ain't bless y'all, but that bless me. No more else for me. Think about this. The kingdom is big. Remember this. Another kingdom. Jesus talked about the kingdom all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He kept saying the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God is light. The kingdom of God. We talk about everything but the kingdom of God. And that's what he talked about. He kept talking about the kingdom of God, kingdom of God, kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven, kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God is like.
Right.
Yeah.
It's what you need to know about the kingdom of God, kingdom of God. And guess what? Every time he preached the kingdom,
He preached the kingdom first, and then he healed.
Yeah.
Right.
The Bible, he preached the kingdom, and then he says, multitudes were healed.
Yeah.
Because kingdom, when you speak of the kingdom, it raises your level of expectation.
That's right.
And then you're open, because you're in, you're seated next to him.
Yeah.
And there ain't no sickness next to him.
That's right.
I'm sorry.
Wow. It's a great teaching tonight. It's like, it really needed to be taught.
Child, I taught myself. I didn't know that. God is good.
Yes, he is.
Listen, you need to start. We're going to tackle this kingdom thing. We got to figure this thing out. Because that's the key.
Yes.
He said, whatever you loose in heaven, loose on earth shall be loose in heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. That means I gave you the power to loose or bind whatever you want. And whatever you do here is up here. Mm-hmm. Whatever's up here, you bring down here. Mm-hmm. Let's just exchange it. Mm. How is that possible? It's because you got dual citizenship. It's because you are part of this world. You're in the world, but you're not of it. You're in the world, but you operate it from a kingdom standpoint.
Yeah.
And since you operate from a kingdom standpoint, you get to bring the kingdom principles here on earth, and you get to rule. You get to have rulership when there's another king. That's why he's the king of kings.
Yeah.
Y'all better stop, because I'm going to go all night. But amen.
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 We're going to command ourselves to bless the Lord. We're going to command ourselves to make sure that we speak well of him, speak life.
Yes, God.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.